Assalamu alaikum, dear students. I hope you all are hale and hearty. Here we are with our lecture number 11. It's from unit number 9. It's a beautiful short story, namely The White Lamb. And the author is Khanzadian. Khanzadian is a Romanian author. Translated by Fana Glagolova. First year English compulsory. It's Sumaira Zaheer, your teacher from Army Burnhall College for Girls. Let's begin with it. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. First of all, about Sero Khanzadian. He was born in 1915 in Gores. After graduating from Pedagogical College, he worked at Tatev Secondary School as a teacher of Armenian language and literature. Before that, he taught at Special School of Police. Then he moved to Natshak. You can pronounce it Khatsak as well in Romanian, and taught at the school there. Khanzadian's first story titled Dry Desert was published in 1934 in Red Zangzor newspaper of Gores. Khanzadian became popular owing to the soil, the novel Soil, which was written in 1954 to 1955. A little bit about Armenian literature. The Armenian literary tradition began early in the 5th century AD with religious tracts and histories of the Armenians. A secular literature developed in the early modern period, and in the 18th century, Armenian Catholic monks of the Mekhetarist order began publishing ancient texts, modern histories, grammars and literature. In the 19th century, Armenians developed their own journalism and public theater. Summary of the story. I hope you are going to enjoy it. It's a very beautiful and heart-wrenching and touching story. Navasad, the main character of the story, an old man. Navasad had a son whom he had sent for education, higher education, to Moscow. Navasad had no other living relative except Arshak, and Arshak was also not his real son. He was his brother's son, and he was adopted by him after his brother's death. One day the team leader told Navasad that his son had come back, and it's been many years, like it's been 10 years, the old man had been waiting for him. So one day his team leader told him that your son has come back to village. He had seen him in a blue sedan in the village. Navasad became happy and hurried towards the village because he had not seen Arshak for 10 years. He had waited for him impatiently. He plucked watermelon from the orchard because Arshak loved watermelons. He packed figs in a basket for his son and took a 6-month-old lamb with him for Arshak to eat its meat. He set out for the village. On his way to village, people asked him the purpose of his visit to the village, like he used to work in the orchards outside the village, and now why he's coming early. So that's why the people asked him. He proudly told them that his son had come back home. On the way home, the old man recalled his past life spent with his son. He recalled each and every event happened in the past. He recalled every tree and every place where he sat, played and walked with his son. He remembered the tree Arshak had fallen from and had broken his leg. He thought of the things he had sold for Arshak's education in the city. Finally, the old man reached his home, but did not see his son at home. He entered the yard and set the basket on the ground and tossed an armful of grass to the lamb. He cleaned the house and made it neat for his son. He recalled the story of the bowl he bought for his son. He lit fire and took a knife to slaughter the sheep, but changed his mind and decided to wait till Asha comes. He laid the fruit on the windowsill because he was afraid of spoiling the fruit, because he did not have refrigerator, so he placed the fruit on the windowsill. The sun was setting down and there was no sign of Arshak, like it was getting very late and eve was approaching. Darkness was prevailing, was about to prevail, but the sun was nowhere. He sent a neighbor child to the chairman's house, but Arshak did not come. It was getting very dark and the fire died down. The old man, tired of waiting, slept on the table. A neighboring woman awakened the old man in the morning. He asked her about Arshak. She replied that he had gone back. The old man climbed to the roof and saw Arshak's car speeding along the road and disappeared from his sight. The old man got very dejected, very sad, and he took his lamp and returned to the orchard with sunken eyes and swooped back. So this is what happened to him. First, we will discuss the plot of the story. The plot is very, very simple. The main characters are introduced in the beginning with the conflict, the meeting of Navasad with Arshak. The action flows smoothly and Navasad goes to village for meeting Arshak. The climax occurs when Navasad reaches home but does not see Arshak because he stays at chairman's house for some important work or some official work. The action falls when Navasad is awakened by a neighbor and sees Arshak's car speeding down the road. The resolution comes when Navasad returns to the orchards without seeing Arshak and with a heavy heart, with a very sad heart or broken heart. He goes back to the orchard. So this is the depiction of the plot, how plot is depicted in a story. It starts from here. This part is called exposition, and exposition is the part which is the beginning of the story when the major character is introduced to the reader. Then this is the rising action. Rising action means when the main character faces a series of conflicts or problems, that is called rising action. Rising action reaches the climax. Climax is what? This is the most exciting part of the story, and here we learn about the outcome of the this arising action or conflict. Okay, what is going to happen? And falling action. In falling action, events they lead to the end of the story. They all, after climax, lead towards the end of the story, and resolution is where the conflict is solved or the story is concluded. So this is a depiction of the plot in a story. So this is the text before us. It's lengthy, but I will try to read it quickly. The old gardener, Navasad, went down to the spring that welled up under the nut tree to wash and to rest. After doing some work in the orchard, he went down to the old gardener. It means Navasad was a gardener as well. So So he went near the spring which was welled up which was dug up near the nut tree. Nut can be walnut or nut can be apricot tree, to wash and to rest. No sooner had he bent down to let the cool water splash on his sunburned face than he heard the team lead, like the moment he was washing his face, he heard his team leader calling, "Hey Navasad, hurry, hurry, your son Ashik is back." "What?" the old man said excitedly. He became very happy and then straightened up with difficulty. With difficulty, obviously he was an old man, so it was very difficult for him to get up quickly and stand up quickly. So he rushed back up to where the man was standing with an agility surprised for his years. Agility also means to behave as if you are very active. So actively he reached there and asked him, "What did you say? When did he come? Where is he?" "He's in the village. I saw him myself. He's driving a blue sedan. It's a car. Riding through the village. Lucky you, Navasad. God has blessed you with a fine son. Look, your son has come back after 10 years and he has become a rich man. He's driving a beautiful car and obviously he must have earned a lot of money as well. So you are so lucky that God has blessed you with a son." The sun began to shine 10 times as brightly as before. Sun was shining very brightly. Navasad felt he was walking on air, like he was walking quickly, briskly. His heart pounded from excitement and his heart was also pounding. Navasad seemed to be pondering, thinking over something as he looked in the direction of the village, but then he turned sharply and ran towards the wine press instead. Wine press is the place where he used to keep his all, or might be his apple, that can be his orchard. He had not seen Ashik for 10 years. Each year he would look at the road, hopefully, like it's been 10 years and Ashik had never come to meet him. So he used to wait him for him. It was always his. He had waited patiently and now at long last he would see him. Like after such a long time, now he can see him. Ashik had come at a good time. The fruit in the orchards had ripened and was still hale and hearty. Like he himself was hale and hearty. He was very fit and fine and his health was perfect. So this was the best time that Ashik has visited, as the fruits had all ripened and they were ready to eat. Navasad had no living relatives left in the village. He had no other blood relation in the village. His life had never been a happy life. He had never had any children of his own and his wife had died many years before. His brother and sister-in-law had both died of hunger during the war. So they died due to hunger during the war, leaving an only son, Ashik. So Ashik was his brother's son. He adopted him. Navasad picked up the spade that lay on the ground by the edge of the ditch and began to dig. The earth was moist and smelled of wine. The earth was smelling fine. He extracted a small jug he had buried 10 years before and was pleased at the touch of the cold earthenware vessel. So he had buried wine in deep in the soil in a vessel. So he then dug it in, took out some for Arshak. Sniffing the delicate aroma, a good fragrance of the wine, he smiled and said to himself, "It's turned into lion's milk. Like this wine is so precious now, as precious as a lion's milk." Then he recalled that the largest of the watermelons had ripened. Then he went to the watermelon field and he, under the huge mulberry tree by the river bank, he cut its stem, wiped the silvery dust from the melon, and he picked up a beautiful big watermelon from the melon with he wiped the dust with the hem of his long jacket, with the edge of his long jacket, and admired its shiny stripes. My Aashiq loves watermelons, he mumbled when you speak in without opening your mouth. He got down on his, or you whisper, on his knees, put his arms around the melon and squeezed hard with his ear to the rind. Rind or rind is the skin of the melon. He nodded approvingly at the sound. He then went over to the fig tree, climbed with difficulty and began picking the honey sweet fruit, like he started picking some figs as well that had been pecked at the here. And pecked means some of the birds or the birdies, they have tried to eat it by biting with their beaks. So there were stains of the beaks on it. He chose the best figs and packed them gently into a bright woven basket. Then Navasad set out along the bank to where a 6-month-old white lamb was grazing. He was saving the lamb for a special occasion. So this was the lambie he picked up and he had kept for this special day. He wanted to slaughter it or to cook it on that day when Aashiq is back. So Aashiq has come home. I have finally lived to see this day, Navasad said to himself, and untethered the lamb. Untethered the lamb means it was tied. So he untied the lamb. It bleated. It cried loudly, the lambie. Let's go, fellow, Navasad said. Come on, Aashiq is home. He climbed the steep path to the village, the heavy basket pressed on his shoulders. The wine splashed in the jug, while the meek and gentle, the very obedient, disciplined lambie either ran on ahead or fell behind him. Lamb was following him. Where are you going? Where are you going on so early in the day? The people met him and asked him. Aashiq replied that proudly. Navasad replied proudly that Aashiq is home. On the way, each tree and bush, each stone and spring reminded him of Aashiq. So here he is recalling his childhood. Many were the times that he had carried the child up the steep path on his back, like he's recalling the way he has lived with Aashiq and the way he has taken him to all these places, the way he had played with him, the way he had made him to enjoy his life in his childhood. So this is all he's recalling, Aashiq's childhood. Navasad would give Aashiq a pear and would wipe his nose with the hem of his long jacket. There was the spring which Aashiq liked to drink from, there was a spring, running spring, from where Aashiq used to drink water. Navasad would cup his hands and he would give Aashiq water by cupping his hands, like he used to bring water to Aashiq in his hands. So he's recalling all those good memories. Here was the small orchard. The trees still bore fruit abundantly and stayed green far into the autumn. When Aashiq was 7, he had fallen from the cherry tree. So he recalls a day when Aashiq was hardly 7 years old and he was climbing the cherry tree, and while climbing he fell down and he broke his leg. Navasad had carried him the many miles to the doctor in the distant settlement, and then Navasad had to carry him to the doctor in a faraway village. Then Navasad thought of all the things he had sold to outfit Aashiq for city life. Like, he was not a rich and wealthy person, he was a poor farmer, a poor gardener. So he had to sell so many his precious things to fulfill the needs of Aashiq, or to fulfill his fee over there and other expenses. So when he had sent the boy off to study, he had to sell many of his precious things. It had been a long stretch, but Aashiq had graduated from the university and had then gone on to study in Moscow. He had risen high in the world. Now he has reached an exalted status and he is an officer now. So Navasad is happy. It's okay if I have spent so many things for him or sacrificed so many things. So, but it's okay. Now he has become an officer. Navasad would often tell his fellow villagers about the very important work Ashik was doing in the capital, about his grand car, and also that he lived in the biggest house in Moscow. The old man was in a hurry to reach the village. The wine splashed in the jug and the meek and timid lamb following him. He finally reached his house but did not see Ashik's car over there. Why didn't he drive right up here? Navasad wondered. He thought, what am I talking about? The gravel's too sharp here. He might be thinking about the sand over there, or the road was not concrete road or carpeted road. So he's thinking maybe that's why he had not brought his car here. He was probably afraid that he would ruin his car's tires. So it's a good thing he didn't drive up to the house. He himself is questioning, he himself is answering now, since he is very optimistic. His one-story flat-roofed house with a terrace and an earthen floor made up of soil or mud was like an eagle's nest. Eagle's nest, a very high a house built at a high lofty mountain. His house was looking a picture of an eagle's nest stuck onto the mountain slope, because it was situated just near the mountain, one among many other mountains. Navasad entered the yard, set the jug and basket on the ground, tossed the armful of grass to the lamb. He gave some grass to the lamb and looked about. For the first time in his life, the house looked pitiful and decrepit to him. Pitiful and decrepit, like he thought, my house is giving a very pathetic picture, like it is not looking very neat and tidy. Worn out and old and not neat and tidy. Well, it's Ashik's house too. This is where he grew up. Then he thought, it's okay what sort of house it is, but it's Ashik's house as well. He won't be ashamed of his own house. So how can he be ashamed of his own house? He consoled himself and then started clearing, sweeping the yard. Congratulations, Navasad, Ashik's come back home. It was the old neighbor woman looking over the fence. Navasad flushed with joy. Thank you, and may your wanderer return as well, he replied. Ki may your son also come back. I saw Ashik. Was he here? No, I went to the shop for a package of needles and saw him standing out in front of the farmhouse. What a fine boy he is. You would never say he was not Asha's son. I just could not take my eyes off him. May the Lord bless you. And now the neighbor woman is praising Ashik, that he's looking very handsome, and he was standing near the farmhouse. Thank you, the old man said in a voice that was thick from emotion. He went about tidying up the yard with zeal, with great fervor, with enthusiasm. First he swept up the dirt. I don't want my boy to dirty his shoes. Then he hammered in a protruding coming out, bulged out nail with a rock, and then Ashik might catch his sleeve on it, he thought, and tear his jacket. Navasad opened the door. A cot stood forlornly against the bare wall. There was a cot standing there near the lonely wall, and that was the cot where Ashik used to obviously sleep. I'll say, remember how you slept on this bed, Ashik, and I slept here on the floor, he was thinking aloud. He smoothed the cover. I'll say, this is your old bowl, the one you ate from. Look, Ashik, this is your wooden spoon. Remember the day I bought it from the woodcarver Manas, and you were angry because there was no design on it, and then I took it to the artist and had it painted for you. Now he's thinking about all these things. Conversing thus in thought with Ashik, he set out for the spring, brought back some water, and sprinkled the yard, the terrace, and the floor inside. Then he began to sweep. Once again, the old neighbor woman, had appeared over the fence. Navasad, do you know that Ashik has gone over to the chairman's house? Now she told him that your Ashik is going towards the chairman's house. When did he go there? Just before you got back. He must have seen there was no one at home and gone over there. Now again he is thinking that Ashik has gone to the chairman's house because I was not here at home. So that's why he had gone there. He himself is giving reasons to all these questions. So Navasad brought some kindling wood, the wood that can catch fire quickly, and stacked it by the outdoor fireplace. Then he took his knife from his belt and went over to, like, the moment he wanted to slaughter the lamb, at the last moment he changed his mind. I will wait till Ashik come, he decided, and looked in the direction of the chairman's two-story. How the chairman is the chairman of the land, so obviously he is a very rich person, and he had a big two-story house. What's keeping him? Now he's thinking, why he has gone there? What's keeping him there? It will be dark soon. The figs will get spoiled, and the kernel will lose its taste. So he might lose all these things. He took the food from the basket and laid it on the windowsill because he did not have any refrigerator sort of thing. So he placed them openly on the windowsill. Then he borrowed a new tablecloth from the neighbor and covered the table. Shook out the rug, covered the couch, and put a pillow on it. Everything was now ready. Still, Ashik had not come back. So he is thinking why he is at the chairman's house. Saying Ashik is an important. Then he started thinking that since Ashik is an important man now, he is a big officer. So obviously he might have some kind of discussion for to be done with the chairman, or some important task. So that's why he hasn't come to me yet. He had to drop by and ask the chairman about how things are in the village. He's now thinking, and himself is giving reasons for all this thing. So then what happened? The sun was setting, but still Ashik had not come home, and the old man's anxiety mounted. His anxiety was aggravating. He was getting very upset and very tensed. Why he hasn't come yet? Now it was getting very dark. There was a moment when he was about to set out. First he wanted to go himself to chairman's house and to ask, but later on then he changed his mind. He went out into the yard and called to his neighbor's grandson, "Run over and see what Ashik is doing there. Tell him I'm at home and waiting for him." So he sent the neighbor's grandson to go quickly and to check out and ask Ashik to come back home quickly. The boy was back in no time. "Well, did you see Ashik?" "Yes." "What's he doing?" "Drinking wine." "Oh, he's drinking wine at chairman's house. Did you tell him that I am home?" "Yes." "What did he say?" "He said, all right." See, Ashik replied, "All right." You must note it down. Navasad repeated the words to himself. "Well, then that means he will soon be home. I'll start the fire for the shashlik meanwhile." Shashlik is a food which is made up of noodles, especially. He soon had a good fire going on the fireplace. Then he set to the cleaning the skewers. He went back into the house, wiped the dust off the lamp, and into the lamp and back into the house, wiped dust off the lamp, and sat down at the table. Time dragged on endlessly, but time was passing by. So the lights went on in the village, and the houses took on a cozy look. The street's noises were dying down. Soon the only sound was that of dogs barking mournfully in the distance. So no other sound was coming now because it was getting very dark. Ashok had still not returned. The fire died down, leaving a mound of ashes. Now fire died down and fire finished, and there were only ashes left in the fireplace. While the lamb lay on the grass chewing its curd, Navasad was all ears. All ears, he was all attentively listening. He peered into the darkness, his eyes became strained and started to tear, his head felt heavy. He rose, but his feet refused to budge, to move. Why should I go begging him? I'm older than him. He should come to me, he began to grumble, but then consoled himself once again by saying, well, he's an important man, he's an official person, so he might get late. Maybe he has some important business with the chairman, so that's why he hadn't come. He will certainly come home in the morning. But still he waited far into the small hours. The autumn night was drawing to a close. Autumn night, obviously autumn nights are quite cold nights. So the old man grew, the man's eyes grew dim from peering intently into the darkness, like looking into the darkness again and again. Now his eyes were also getting tired. So he was gradually overcome by slumber. So eventually he went into sleep. Slumber means sleep. Navasad fell asleep and he was sitting at the table. He did not know how long he had slept. He was awakened by the neighbor woman's voice calling from the yard. He opened his eyes and was surprised to see the first rays of the sun peeping on into the window. Navasad, hey Navasad. He rushed out of the house and looked over the fence. How come you have slept so late today? What is it? Is Ashok on his way here? No, she said. She shook her head. Your Ashok is leaving the town. Look at the road. No. Note it down, underline these lines. Navasad felt as if the roof had come down on his head. Like he felt so bad, he was so saddened to hear that his son Ashok is leaving without seeing him. He ran over to the low shed and climbed to the roof. Ashok's car was speeding along the road, glittering in the sun, quickly becoming smaller and smaller and smaller. His unsteady gait was that of an old man. Unsteady gait, walk. Navasad was making his way down the path of the orchards. Now he was looking very, very old and very, very weak person. He was moving back to the orchards. His eyes that stared at the ground seemed to have become sunken. His back seemed more stooped, like he has leaned bent forward than ever. The white lamb gambolled after him, like the lamb was walking, running after him, and he was looking more old and pathetic and stooped and stooped. His body was looking very stooped and his eyes were sunken, looking very deep with anguish and worries, and with because of this sad event that his only son had not seen him, not met him after 10 years and had gone back to village. This story is very, very heart-wrenching. So moral of the story is, parental love is the only love that is truly selfless, unconditional and forgiving. We never know the love of a parent till we become parents ourselves. It's very, very true. You can never feel the pain, the worries, the miseries, the sacrifices given by your parents until and unless you yourself become parents. There is a comparison or the differences between the characters of Navasad and Arshak. So we can call it Navasad is protagonist and Arshak is antagonist. Navasad is the main positive character, Arshak is the negative character. So Navasad was kind-hearted, loving, caring, hard-working, sacrificing, remembers past, simple man, a true friend. And Arshak, he's ruthless, merciless, unkind, mean, he's a very mean person, greedy, he's a flatterer, careless, selfish, forgets past, cunning, a fair weather friend, a friend who loves you only for his own purposes. So this is the character sketch differences of both the major characters. There's a very famous quote of Shakespeare. I quote it here. How sharper than a serpent's tooth it is to have a thankless child. Serpent, you know it. These snakes, etc. So it was taken from Shakespeare's King Lear. I hope you know the story of King Lear. King Lear, who had three daughters, and once he asked all his daughters, how much do you love me? And one of the daughters said truly and honestly, I love you the way a daughter should love her father. And then he abandoned her. So this quote truly fits the story of Navasad. Navasad brings up Arshak, an orphan nephew. He fulfills his every wish when he was a child. He plays with him and takes care of him. He sends him for higher education to city Moscow. He supports him, but when he becomes an officer and is able to earn money, he forgets about his uncle and forgets about all the sacrifices done by his uncle and leaves him alone there without even meeting him and seeing him. He does not bother to meet him when he comes to village and goes back without seeing him. So this quote of Shakespeare is very, very much relevant in this situation of Navasad. Now the significance of the title, the white lamb. White symbolizes innocence and piety, and lamb symbolizes purity. So that's why they have kept the name the white lamb. We can conclude this as well, that the lamb was not eaten by Arshak because he did not deserve to eat such a pure and such an innocent lamb. He was not pure at heart, that's why he did not eat its meat. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam has said, and I quote, he who wishes that his sustenance, livelihood, eatables, all these things be increased for him and his death be delayed, then he should pay attention to his kinsfolk. See, our Holy Prophet has said, if you are good with your relatives, with your blood relations, with your family members, then definitely you will get a long life and a long sustenance as well. Theme or crux of the story: do not tie your hopes with someone or even with your loved ones, like even with your children. You should not tie up so many hopes, because you never know when they get up, what would they do? This theme is very much relevant to our culture and society, because we see many old parents waiting for their kids, residing in foreign countries, and not visiting their parents for many, many years. We also find such old people living in old homes in spite of their loved ones' presence. So we can say we have seen many people around us who have no supporter and a lot of supporters. Like there are so many relatives, but no one is supporting them and are living a solitary life. So most of the people who are living in the old homes or orphanages, they are usually abandoned by their own loved ones, especially their children. So this is so heart-wrenching reality of our society, along with Romanian society, we can say. So it's a beautiful story. I hope you have enjoyed it. So we will discuss the exercise on our WhatsApp group. Most of the questions, answers you will find out from here as well. So okay, take good care of yourself and your parents as well. Do not tease them and be very obedient children. Allah Hafiz. Have a good day.